So anyway, so we go on, and we talk about George O'Donnell, Frederick, Thomas O'Donnell. He was the last of the O'Donnells in Newport, and as you can see from the date of his death, he was only just 30 when he died. He died the 16th of June, and he'll be dead 100 years next month. And I thought it was a suitable topic for a lecture, and I've been doing a bit of research over the last 10 years into who he was, and it was only recently that I was able to find a picture of him, even though he died in 1916-15, and you'd have thought that there would have been plenty of photographs, but I only find one or two of them. We actually went over to look to see the exact place where he died, and his body was never found, so he's commemorated on what's called the Men in Gate, where people were commemorated that the bodies weren't found. If the bodies were found, they were buried, and there was a marker put up over their grave to say where they were. Some of you may have seen in the annual last year, I wrote an article of all the people in the parish that had died. It was 19 people from the parish that died. They didn't all die in the British Army. Some of them died in the Australian Army, some of them died in the Canadian Army, some of them died in the United States Army. So there was quite a lot of people. I'm not going to mention all the people here tonight. I'm going to concentrate just on George Frederick Thomas O'Donnell. And the reason his name is so, he's got O'Donnell in it twice, is because his surname actually is Thomas hyphen O'Donnell. There should be a hyphen in there. And his would be that this was taken after the war, because all these names in here, there were 600 pupils from Cheltenham College that were killed in the First World War, and they were all on this plaque here. So it was a very genteel sort of a school. A lot of the landlords would send their children to school in England. The Stoneys mostly went to school in Harrow. And so it would be, I don't know where Edwin Thomas went to school. He wasn't a landlord class, as you can see from his pedigree. He was more of a church type family. So they probably stayed in Ireland to get their education. This is the museum of all sorts of different things that they had. And this is the dining room, I think, and the church. Okay, so as you saw before, when he was in the swimming gaffer, he moved on and he was he joined up in June of 1903. Here is his Lieutenant G.O. Donel. And this is in the Donegal Artillery, which was also known as the Prince of Wales. And then in 3 years later, he left the Donegal Artillery and he joined the Royal Fusiliers, the Donegal Artillery is sort of like the equivalent of the FCA, it's sort of a reserve type of regiment. It's not, they probably did get involved in the First World War because they called up a lot of reserve men, but they wouldn't be, they'd be sort of like the militia, that's what they would be. And we have them in South Mayo and the North Mayo militia here. This is the cap badge of the Royal Fusiliers, and here's another picture. Now, following along to the 1911 census, you can see the 1911 census. Here he's at camp, and all these ones here are Norman Reginald McMahon, Major. Thomas Raymond Matlock, he's another Major, age 45 and 43. And we go right down here to, here he is, he's highlighted because they served him, he's highlighted in yellow. An interesting person that you can see there, here we are, Mars James Dees, second lieutenant, 21, single, from Westmeath. He was the first person to get a Victoria Cross in the First World War. And I'll show you a little bit about how he got that now. But this is frightening, looking at that 1911 census, and those are the people transcribed. There was one, two, three that I couldn't find out what happened to them. But all the ones in red all died in the First World War. And you know, some of them lived as long until 1968. So some of you, if George O'Donnell had survived, would probably have met him. You know, he if there was people that were of his age group that lived until 1968. So you know, he'd have another probably 40 years to live if he hadn't died in the war. So this photograph here now is taken the day before they go off to war. And they all look very jolly. And this is Major McMahon. He's the leader of the regiment. And there's George Thomas O'Donnell beside him. He's sort of his right-hand man. He's the one that keeps track of all the where they move. And we'll look at the diary shortly as to what happened during the war. This is in St. George's Church in Newport, where we went to visit. And you can see on the one of the windows here, there's the O'Donnell crest. These are two other people that are commemorated in this window here. But for those of you who can't read it, it says, George Thomas O'Donnell, MC. That was a decoration he got for taking part in a battle in November of 1914. Captain Adjutant, 4th Battalion Royal Fusiliers, killed in action in Bellamore Bridge, Menin Road, 16th of June 1915, age 30. Only and dearly loved child of Edwin and Millicent Thomas O'Donnell of Newport House. So to refresh your memory, or those of you that don't, you know, haven't followed what was talked about the First World War, this is it, Wikipedia, and it sort of gives you the timeline of the First World War. And what started off was the assassination of the Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria, heir to the Austro-Hungarian throne, who was killed in Sarajevo, along with his wife Duchess Sophie, by a Bosnian Serb, Gavrilo Princip. Now, he was only one of them. There were several people involved, but he was the one that got caught. Austro-Hungary seeks German support for war against Serbia in case of Russian militarism. Germany gives assurances of support. Austro-Hungary sends an ultimatum to Serbia. The Serbian response is seen as unsatisfactory. This is July at 23. Now, we haven't got much land to go before the war breaks out. We're between England and Ireland and Germany. Austria-Hungary declares war on Serbia. Russia mobilizes. The Netherlands declares neutrality. Germany warns Russia to stop mobilizing. Russia says mobilization is against Austria-Hungary only. Okay, now we're into August the 1st. Germany declares war on Russia. Italy declares its neutrality. Germany and the Ottoman Empire sign a secret alliance treaty. Then Germany starts invading. They're going to invade in France, and they've got a mighty army, and they can take over the whole of Europe. They invade Luxembourg. They skirmish at Chantilly. It's the first military action on the Western Front. It besieges and captures a place called Longwy, the Iron Gate to Paris, near the Luxembourg border, opening France to mass German invasion. This was sort of a bottleneck that they could have been stopped if they had troops there to stop them from coming in. So they declare war on France. Belgium denies permission for German forces to pass through the French border. And this is what brought England into war, the United Kingdom as it was at the time. Germany invades Belgium to outflank the French army. Britain protests the violation of Belgian neutrality guaranteed by a treaty that had been signed previously. But the German Chancellor replies that the treaty was just a scrap of paper. So that then in August the 4th, the United Kingdom declares war on Germany. The United States declares neutrality, and as you've seen recently, it was only with the sinking of the Lusitania that they entered the war. And there was talk that they might have entered the war on the other side if that hadn't happened. August the 4th and 16th, the Germans besiege and then capture the fortresses of Liège. And the Belgians held out longer than they expected that they would, which gave the British Army time to get into Europe and get the close to the Germans. Montenegro declares war on Austria-Hungary. The Ottoman Empire closes the Dardanelles. We won't talk about the Dardanelles, but there's been a lot of talk about that recently. Austria-Hungary declares war on Russia. Serbia declares war on Germany. And then on August the 7th, the expeditionary forces arrive in France. Now, where did I go to find out stuff about this? First of all, he was in the 4th Royal Fusiliers from the census. The regiments are made up into brigades and then into divisions. So when you're looking at stuff about the First World War, you'll see that they mention the 9th Infantry and the 3rd Division. And then when you get on to the Battle of the Somme, you'll hear about the 10th Division and the 16th Division. But that's in 1916, that's the next year. So this is in Kew in London, right beside Kew Gardens, is this fantastic place called the National Archives, where the actual diary that he'd written, you can see his handwriting where he'd written and describing everything that happened in the war, was there. This is a book I got, The Royal Fusiliers in the Great War. This was written around about the time of the war by one of the generals that participated in it. And the Battle of Belle War, this book just only came out this year, too, because they're having a commemoration of where the battle took place and various people being invited. The war diary is on the internet. You can get it on this thing. Anybody that's interested in any of these, I can send on the links to them. Okay, so we start off and we look at the diary. This diary now was I transcribed it all, and then I found out once I had it all transcribed, somebody else had done the same and it was on the internet. It still took about a week's work to do it, copying it all out and things. But so at the beginning, he's really, you know, he's been in the army for 10 years. He's seen very little action. He was based in Parkhurst in the Isle of Wight, and this is a hospital that's in it, and I think it's part of it is a prison as well. You've heard of Parkhurst prison, so this is where he was based. Some of the other regiments in the Royal Fusiliers went to India and exciting places like that, but he seems to have spent most of his time either in Ireland or in the Isle of Wight. So it was ordered on the 4th of August when they declared war, and the first day of mobilisation, two officers and three NCOs proceeded to Hounslow, which was where they were going to start sending the people out from. And the second day, 384 reservists joined from Hounslow. This was one of the places in London where they had their barracks, and the reserve people would be drilling there, and they were called up in the war and they came along. And as you can see a little bit later, they took them a while for the reservists to get used to the thing. O'Donnell himself had been trained for 10 years, so he was well trained to go to war. Some of these other people had just been doing what you do in the FCA. They bought up the horses and they got all the people that they needed, and they arrived at the depot, and then they're just about getting ready to to go. Alterations had to be made to the smaller arms ammunition carts that they were doing, and they were all mobilised on the 8th of August. And here you can see them. This is another photograph. I showed the one before with the regimental dog, and here he is here to the right again of Major McMahon. But they really don't look that upset about going off to war. Like, it's something that they've been looking forward to, and they thought at the beginning of the war that it was only going to last for a couple of weeks. So the fifth day of mobilisation, the transport was inspected by the commanding officer, reserve drilled by the company. So they did a lot of drilling, and they left Falmouth, and there was three officers and 234 other ranks went, and then a little bit more drill before they went. The Sergeant Taylor left to make sure that all their uniforms were properly. And then 4 days later, they were off to Cowes, and they left Parkhurst for Southampton, and they embarked on the ship, the Smartbond was the name of the ship, and they sailed to France. So it only took them about 8 days from when the war was declared for them to be in France. So here, this is the Isle of Wight, and here they are in the harbour. Okay, so they arrived at the harbour, and they left for the rest camp about 7 miles away. Even after walking only 7 miles, many people fell out because of the great heat and large number of reservists that weren't used to marching big long distances. And it was very wet, and a lot of them got blisters, and they couldn't walk, and their supplies didn't keep up with them, so that they were there in the line in ditches and trying to sleep in ditches, so that they were very bad. And then they got to just outside Harbour, and they got the train. The train went to Landrecies, and then they left Landrecies and marched to Noyon. When they were still in friendly territory in France, they could get the trains to take them wherever they want. Obviously, by the time they got to the occupied territory, the trains wouldn't be running. But here you see them walking in through the harbour, and they all seem very jolly. And the French people welcomed them, and they sang the Marseillaise, and so the Royal Fusiliers responded with a music hall hit called "Hold Your Hands Out, Normandy Boy." And the French people applauded that. They thought that was the English national. So then they go on, and in peacetime, billets would be nice barracks that they'd be in and everything, but this would be just maybe an old shed that they commandeered and put down some bedding in it. And it's not really, some of the billets he complains about later on and aren't really very good. And so when they had the marches, they marched about 6 miles, and 4 men fell out, 18 men were sent back sick, and they're at the beginning of it, they're not quite hardened up. And they're going up along now here, and within just about a week of landing, they're in Mons. And they started crossing the Belgian frontier with Malbec and the advance guard, and they put out an outpost position, guarding crossings over the canal. So the canal, they thought, might be a place that they could stop the advance of Germans, and they guarded it there. And they had a quiet night. So here, this is where they started. They started in the harbour, and they've gone as far as Mons. Okay, now this is the first battle that they have. It's August the 23rd. They're only in France a matter of a week and a half. And they're still holding out the outpost position. A certain amount of desperate firing took place in the early morning. We wounded and captured 2 Uhlan officers. This is a name that they use for some of the Germans. They have all these names that they call Germans, and it's quite hard to understand exactly what they all are. I think some of them are fairly slang. So the Germans started to attack us seriously with apparently at least 4 battalions of infantry and also cavalry artillery. So they were quite outnumbered there. They were on one side of the canal, the Germans were on the other side of the canal. We suffered severely on the bridge over the canal by rifle and artillery fire. Machine guns had a particularly trying time. Practically all the detachment, including Lieutenant Deese, the machine gun officer, were killed or wounded. Lieutenant Deese and Private Godley both displayed most conspicuous gallantry working guns after being wounded. Private Godley survived, and he survived the war, and he got a Victoria Cross as well. The 2 of them were manned machine gun positions until it had been completely disabled. So 1:40 p.m. they were ordered to retire, and then 2 hours later they retired, and for the next week they're basically in retreat. And the total casualties by the battalion and commands were about 112 killed or wounded, including 7 officers. So they lost about a third of their unrest battalion. Sorry, they lost quite a lot of people there. It'd be about 1,000 of them that added. So they arrived in Sydney in bivouac there until 2 a.m. So this is Morris Dease here and Private Godley there. And you can see them, this is the day before, they don't seem to be that worried at all, you know, they're relaxing in the square and Mons. But this is a painting of all the artillery firing on top of their machine gun post here and their white tub. So they marked the position to take just north of Sydney in conjunction with the 7th Fusiliers. And at dawn on the 24th of August, the Germans attacked again, not very heavily, but with orders to return, and did so through Gently about 10 a.m. Marked to Birmingham is in the direction of Hotel. And so they did a lot of marching back and forwards here, and they're not getting in the trenches here. They're moving around quite a bit at the moment, and they'll get in the trenches in about November time. So their planes put out a German Zeppelin out of action, and then they saw a German airplane flying by, and they thought that they brought down a German airplane with a rifle, and they were probably celebrating that. So they retired to another position, and he suffered slightly from shrapnel fire, bursting very accurately into a sunken road. They were into this road that they were taking shelter, and there was shrapnel coming over from the artillery. There was a few other casualties. They were ordered to retire. Some of the generals seemed to countermand each other, and some generals that wanted them to retire, they arrived having marched all night in Hardingport and bivouacked, so they're just sleeping out under canvas sort of ground sheets that they brought to cover over themselves. And so they killed some Germans there, but there wasn't much happening. There's a lot of the time that there's not much happening. And at the beginning of it, he's more into seeing where he's going, and probably they are moving around a bit more, and there's more to say rather than just being in the trenches or being in the villages. So we started off down in here in the harbour, and we went up to Mons, and now we're coming back down again. And they almost go back as far as Paris before they turn around again. So they left Wassen, the rear guard, and they arrived after a very long, hot march and billeted in double billets. And they had a quiet night and then were billeted, and they just sort of saying where they are. It's really only until when you get into the actual battles where they're doing a lot of fighting that you see. But you see things like one officer and 90 of the first reinforcements joined. So they happened to have people all the time. When he died in June of 1915, which was only less than 9 months after the start of the war, he was the only surviving officer that went out there with the regiment. All the rest of them had either wounded or gone home or been killed. So then they were in Charter, and the advance resumed, and they moved in a northerly direction. So they're starting to turn around now and go back again. And so they were informed where their enemy was retreating, and they went after the enemy. So they've come back down here, and now they're starting to go back again. Okay, on the September the 7th, we're not even a month into the war yet. So they left Lumini, and the last battalion in the division that was crowded on Crumpton and March, because they all set off at the same time, and they were getting in each other's way, rather than going off sort of at separated times. So they advanced in an ordinary direction and held up for some hours by the enemy authority. They finally dislodged them and continued the advance, and then they were billeted. So when they were at this stage of the war, when they just came across the enemy, then everybody had to fight. Whereas later on, they would maybe 3 days on and 3 days off, and they'd come back from the front and go into their village. So they advanced north in pursuit of the enemy, and they got in touch with the enemy, and then shelled his transport and drove him from his position north of him, and killed and wounded a large number, so who finally surrendered. So this was they were doing well in this, and then there'd be different parts where they come under fire, like Mons, that they haven't come out of that very well. There's still horses at the beginning of the First World War. You see, our cavalry had skirmished with enemy on the northern bank of the river.
catch some prisoners in Brunel. And you can see when we were starting off that they were rounded up and getting horses. They came to Ireland and they got a lot of horses that the army, they were buying up horses. I don't know if they bought any of Mayo, but they bought, certainly bought a lot in West Ham. They left Billings and marched in a northwest direction towards Bailey. A great deal of artillery firing took place all around them. The battalion halted under cover and took no active part. And dusk resumed on Bailey, and the boat at 11 p.m. crossed the river by an improvised bridge. The crossing was completed by 11:30. Then we ordered to take up a position covering the town on the heights north of the village. So we arrived at the position near the Rouge Maison just after midnight. No attack during the night. At dawn, which was foggy very well, the Germans attacked with strong artillery and machine gun support. The battalion held its ground for some time, but only the regiment on its right giving way had to retire to a sunken road about 200 yards south of the Rouge Maison. This position we held on to. We had many casualties, including 5 officers killed, wounded, and missing, and about 200 other ranks also killed, wounded, or missing. This is just the regiment of the 4th Fusiliers. The enemy made a night attack, but we repulsed them with rifles and bayonets. Holding on to our position in sunken road, which we have strongly entrenched and traversed, enemy shelling is a good deal, but we only had 2 casualties. Very wet night. Night attack by enemy was repulsed by rifle fire. The next day, they were still holding on to position. All ranks doing splendidly, still improving our entrenchments. The talk between, if you can read private letters, the way that they describe it is a lot different than the generals. The generals use terms like splendidly, and the privates don't, they don't talk. A good deal of sniping taking place, but we have very few casualties. Still holding on to the position, very wet day. Everyone wet though, as we have no cover. The enemy have been shelling the valley south of us and the bridge of Bailey ever since we came here, but have not done much damage. Expect a night attack from rumours of inhabitants. Stood to arms all night, no attack. Still they hold on to position, fine day, quiet, very wet night. Everybody wet through. So we're getting a little bit closer to where the main fighting is going to be in Ypres and where he eventually gets killed. Fine day, got very severe shelling from the enemy commencing about 2:30 p.m. So they'll be shelling at night and during the daytime. Our own guns hardly replying at all owing to the long range. We had several casualties. Heavy shelling by enemy's artillery at short range continues until about 6 p.m. when it stopped, and there was a general advance to the enemy's infantry. They attacked heavily but repulsed with many casualties by rifle fire. Some of the enemy appeared to get lost in the darkness, and there was some confusion amongst them. One prisoner of the 64th Regiment was captured. Quiet and fine night. Enemy renewed the attack at dawn, but did not press at all. Attack died away after about 2 hours. The enemy still continued to shell us accurately, and we have a few casualties. Our guns gave us more support today than they had done before. They were relieved by the Lincolnshire Regiment after having been 7 days in the firing line, joined by 3rd reinforcements, 1 officer and 92 other ranks. About 3 a.m, 2 regiments of the 6th Division moved to Maison Rouge position and retired across the Corsel and billeted there for much needed rest. Colonel McMahon was complemented by General Hamilton, commander of the 3rd Division, and by General Shaw, commander of the 9th Infantry Brigade, on the work done by the... As you remember the slide I showed you at the beginning, this, the 3rd Division is the top of the thing, then the 9th Infantry Brigade, and then the Royal Fusiliers is a regiment. So those are the general, the two people that are commanding Colonel McMahon, who's in charge of the regiment. About 4 p.m, Sir John French visited the battalion and expressed the men's hearts of appreciation of their work last week. So this is a description of what happens in Rouge Maison. This is some of them in here in the trenches. They're sort of lined up like that, and then they can climb up onto the bank and see what's happening. But they're, you know, the artillery can land it on top of them and cause all sorts of problems. The retreat from Mons took the 4th Battalion through the plateau, and when they were in reserve, they suffered some casualties. They crossed the Marne on the coast, but sustained more casualties than Boyle on the 10th of September. On the 13th, they crossed the island by a narrow plank bridge and set themselves up on the left of Rouge Maison Farm to spend a wet night in the open. On the 14th, they realised that they were far too forward and the Germans rated fire on the right flank. Under heavy firing from machine guns and artillery, the enemy attacked, and although some positions were held, others were forced to withdraw. 4 officers were killed, 1 wounded, and 200 other ranks were killed or wounded. On the 19th of September, they came under heavy bombardment, but a German attack was beaten off, and they spent 8 nights in the trenches there before they were relieved by the Lincolns. Total casualties in the battle were 5 officers killed and 300 other ranks killed or wounded. This is in the regiment of 4th Royal Fusiliers. Of course, that was billeted, joined by the whole brigade, which now became temporary reserve of the army, joined by the 4th Reinforcements, two officers and 186 other ranks. So they're billeted and resting on the 23rd and the 24th. They left Purcell with an infantry regiment marched through Bay to take up position north of the village held by the 8th Infantry Brigade. Arrived at a position on high ground just outside the northwest of the village and west of our original position. About 10 p.m. took over position from Royal Irish Regiment, Lincolnshire Regiment, in position on our left, Middlesex on our right. The position is a curious one, very wooded in place with trenches facing all directions. It's very important to remember that like when they're facing the army, the German army, they all have to line up opposite each other. If one goes too far forward, they can be shot at from the left or from the right as well as from the front. So they try and keep in a straight line and have it. That's what happened with the trenches. And they didn't move back and forwards any because they didn't want to be outflanked by the enemy, either the Germans or the British troops. It's a very strong position now, so the ground is very difficult for the enemy to attack over. You probably have to come by the roads, which we've strongly barricaded. So this is the sort of area that they're in here. They're back not too far away from Mons. There you can see Bailey that we were talking about here, and Courcelles is up there. Okay, on the 26th of September they were in position, shelled by the enemy, no casualties, were joined by the remainder of the 9th Brigade, Northumberland Fusiliers. So there's nothing much happening that week. So in October, a fine day, nothing of importance, no enemy fire today, billeted for the day, billeted. Nothing much happened there either. They go on a train here, they detrain at Point Memney, so they can move them around quite a bit when they're on the right side of the line. And then they got some French motor lorries to take them, a total distance of about 25 miles. So they left on October the 12th, they left the billets at 7 a.m. and marched towards Bain-Chapelle. Arrived there about 3 p.m. A certain amount of shelling was done by the enemy. 8th Brigade attacked but did not make progress. 9th Brigade in reserve. About 5 p.m. returned to billets. So here we are, we're moving further north in. We'll be in Ypres fairly soon. So they left the billets at 4 a.m. They marched to Ypres, right there at 5 a.m. So they're marching at night so that the Germans can't see them. And then they sort of stay where they are during the daytime. And they remained all day billeted in the division reserve. Good deal of firing eastwards. No news can be attained. Some of the problems with the things that was very hard to communicate, and then they would set up telephone lines when they get into the trenches behind them, but if the artillery shells landed on the telephone lines, then they couldn't communicate. So sometimes they couldn't even keep track of where their own people were, so for the artillery to be firing ahead of them. On the way to the advance and take the main road running southeast from Astaire, deployed from Boutteville, proceeded with very little opposition. Occupied the road until by about 5 p.m. and they entrenched in the road the 15th and 16th. They stayed there. Okay, there was on the 18th they were shelled a good deal by the Germans. We were holding loophole houses and trenches in the outskirts of the village. The 5th Fusiliers were also in the village. About 5 p.m. the Scots Fusiliers on our right attacked. Also, this 18th Royal Irish on our left. Our artillery gave no support. Attack was not successful. French attacked at the same time on our left and gained some ground. Their artillery is wonderful. It gives their infantry tremendous support. During the attack, we held hurdies and had about 40 casualties. So we still there in a good deal of shelling again, and the Royal Irish Fusiliers, they suffered badly in that attack there. Okay, so there was more shelling, and he said that some of the houses were broken down. Some of the pictures that you can see of the damage were done, like fine woods and not a tree standing after all the shelling where they would be. And the houses, any of you that were having a little look at that video that I was showing at the beginning, they could see the change in the town of Ypres from 1914 to 18. There was hardly a building standing in it in 1918. So they were ordered out about 12 noon to retake trenches and evacuated by a regiment to the 7th Brigade. This saw that several casualties, including three officers, two were killed. Remaining recaptured trenches the nights of the 25th and the 26th, very wet. The two companies returned to billets at dawn, and those were in the firing line with the 7th Brigade. They made a night attack to try and recapture them, but failed and had very heavy casualties, including eight officers. Okay, so this is what he's talking about in Chapelle. The 4th Battalion were given little rest and were ordered to retake lost trenches on the outskirts of Chapelle. Sir Francis Waller led 2nd Company in the charge against the enemy and was mortally wounded. They captured the trenches and the town was cleared of Germans. Y Company and half of 2nd Company, all under the command of Major Malik, who you saw in the census there, remained in the front line while the rest went into billets. On the 26th of October, the Germans attacked the early hours and a fierce engagement took place in which the trenches were defended until most of the fusiliers had been killed or wounded. The whole battalion was involved, the day wore on, and some trenches were lost. But on the following day, the 27th, they were raided by French Alpine troops and almost regained lost positions, but at heavy cost and casualties. Major Malik was severely wounded, and the battalion was reduced to 8 officers and 350 other ranks. They were relieved on the night of the 29th of October and marched to Mergus. They were later complimented by General Sir Horace Smith Dorning. I simply cannot find words enough to express my admiration for the way in which your regiment has behaved. All through the campaign up to now, they have had the hardest work of any regiment in the brigade, and any work they have done, they have carried out exceedingly well. In fact, I can say that there is no better regiment in the British Army than the Royal Fusiliers. So this is, when O'Donnell was writing the diary, he was just putting snappy little sentences in for each day. But then this is written about 3 or 4 years after the war, when he's talking to survivors and he's read the diaries for the Fusiliers regiment, he's read the diaries for other ones, and he can put a nice paragraph there that sums it all up. It's most of what's on that slide there is in the previous diary, but not quite as easy to read because he's putting in other stuff about it being very wet and stuff like that. So after that battle here, they attacked the enemy again in cooperation with the remains of the 6th Battalion. Very severe fight, nearly recaptured trenches, but were driven back in the end to a new line of trenches. Heavy casualties, including 2 officers, held on to near trenches for the night of the 27th to the 28th. Only 8 officers and 350 other ranks left now. Joined by Lieutenant Stapleton, Bretherton and Routley. There's people coming out all the time. As you saw at the beginning, Lieutenant Stoney was killed in 1917. He'd only been out for 6 weeks before when he got killed. And so they're coming out all the time. And you can sort of look at it and say, well, he only survived 9 months from when he went out in August to when he was killed in June. But like most of the other ones, there was a few of the higher ups survived. Most of the lieutenants would only live for 5 or 6 weeks. And this is the sort of trenches that they're in during the war. So they walked across the Belgian frontier, and there's a bit of sex coming up in a minute to wake you up. Okay? They left the billets about 12 noon and marched to Bayou, joined by 3 officers of other corps, again with the 9th Brigade. They billeted at Bayou, inspected by Sir Horace Smith Dorning, who said what we just saw in the month before, and then they billeted. So here we're getting close to being in the army for about 40 years. He commanded the British 2nd Corps for the Battle of Mons, the first major action fought by the British Expeditionary Force in the Battle of Le Cateau, where he fought a vigorous and successful defensive action contrary to the wishes of the Commander-in-Chief, Sir John French, with whom he had a personality clash dating back some years. In the spring of 1915, he commanded the British 2nd Army at the 2nd Battle of Ypres. He was relieved of the command by French for requesting permission to retreat from the Ypres salient to a more defensible position. Okay, then November the 6th, he left Bayeux at 10 a.m. and marched a position about 3 miles east of Ypres and took over trenches from the cavalry on the night of the 6th to the 7th. From November until June, when he gets killed, they're just stuck in these trenches, back and forth, into billets and in and out of trenches. So it's not, you know, there's not as much happening in the diary from now on in. On our left, blown out of their trenches, but we held on, supported in the evening by the West Riding Regiment, night of the 7th and the 8th, the longest sniping all night. November the 8th, still in trenches, very heavily shelled all day, several attacks by enemy on our trenches. All repulsed, one particularly heavy attack on White Company at about 6 p.m. was repulsed with heavy losses to the enemy. White Company under Lieutenant Stapleton Bretherton charged the enemy who were advancing on our trenches. The company drove the enemy away, but went too far as Lieutenant Bretherton, 2nd Lieutenant Jackson, most of the company are missing. Lieutenant Bretherton only joined 2 slides back. Like he's only come out from England, he's only there, you know, a week or 10 days. Many casualties included, 62 missing. 9th to the 8th and 9th, fairly quiet. The 9th, foggy morning, certain amount of shelling was no heavy attack on our position, but heavy firing on our right. All attacks repulsed all along the line, with very heavy losses to the enemy. Still in the same position, improving, weather very damp. Still in the same position, slightly shelled all day. A good deal of sniping, a few casualties in a quiet night. Terrible shelling around 6:30 a.m. continued for about 2.5 hours. This is the most severe shelling I have seen during the war. Infantry attack followed. It was set by 15th Battalion of the German Imperial Guard. Our line was driven into a certain extent, but with the help of very determined and successful counterattack by the Royal Scots Fusiliers and supported by the Royal Sussex Regiment, the general line was held. Colonel McMahon, now Brigadier General, he was the who you saw that O'Donnell was his right-hand man in the slides at the beginning. He was killed, and also were other officers of the battalion, except Lieutenant and Adjutant O'Donnell and Second Lieutenant McLean. They were all killed, wounded or missing. And this is where he got his military cross here on this particular day. He got his military cross, and he was also mentioned twice in dispatches, which means that somebody high up says that he's done a great job. Okay, collected about 100 men of the battalion all told, no officers, placed in reserve for the day, had to go up to firing line in the evening to support the Scots Fusiliers, joined by 28 men from the hospital. Still in support and heavily shelled in the morning, very heavily shelled in the afternoon. Very wet, total strength, now two officers, O'Donnell and McLean, and 170 other men. Same situation except we had to retire slightly from our old trenches and take up a new line. Snow and rain still holding on, everyone wet and tired through. So there's Colonel McMahon, and he was Brigadier General when he got killed. He was Chief Instructor of Musketry in Hyde from 1905 to 1914, and he was a soldier of rare vision who came from a long line of fighting men. The other O'Donnells before George Thomas had taken part in the militia. They were in the Mayo militia, and none of them were full-time in the army. Some of the other sons that you saw that didn't inherit the estate of Newport gone out to India and been in the army there. Okay, this is talking about the 11th. The morning dawn dull and misty, about 6:30, terrible shelling began. Thomas O'Donnell was in the line, later described as much the most severe I've ever seen. Continued for 2.5 hours. So this is what they said in the history of the regiment, which was written afterwards. Okay, this is a quote from the Battle of Belvoir by a German soldier. He said, on the 10th of November, artillery bombarded the English fire trenches. That evening, I received the news of Brother Victor's heroic death at the same time as the orders were going to be attacked at 10 a.m. on the morning of the 11th. And well, you may imagine with what emotions and courage I proceeded. You will have read of the battle because the English were overwhelmed by this massive attack. There were some sights to see here, like how the rifle butt was used as a weapon. Okay, we'll leave that. So he can on going here now, and it gets a little bit quieter. And at the end of the month, he's allowed to go home. And he's off for 3 weeks. And what does he decide to do when he gets back home? He needs to get married. And who does he get married to? He gets married to Florence Violet Bradell, only daughter of George Claude Flood Bradell of Newlands, County Wexford, and Lockington, County Wiltshire. This is the house in Wiltshire, and this is the house in Wexford. And you can see from her in Lockington in the 1901 census, the father was George Claude Flood Bradell. He wasn't home the night of the census, but his wife was Florence E, and Florence being the daughter. And Florence Lee ends up inheriting the Newport estate. She married after the war, she married, we'll see that now. Okay, she'd previously been married to a fellow called Le Gros, who was also in the Royal Fusiliers. And this is the interesting bit. She'd been married to this fellow called Gros, who was in the regiment, but he was in the 3rd Fusiliers, so he may or he may not have known George Thomas O'Donnell. So what George says is, he said, my dear boy, I regret that I cannot agree to resume life with you. We are, as you know well, absolutely unsuited and never could be happy together. In your interest, and therefore quite as much as in my own, I must decline to return. As regards what I ought to do for you financially, this is a matter which had better be discussed between our respective lawyers. You know, according to my means, my desire would be always to act generously. So they're back and forwards with solicitors' letters. This isn't you as well. But he finally gets fed up and he says, Grand Hotel Trafalgar Square, London, 5th of December 1912. Dear boy, this letter is to tell you that I'm tired of all this fuss and worry, and that to save further annoyance, since I believe I am being watched, I stayed here with a woman last night. Therefore, if you take the proper measures, you can get proof of my unfaithfulness from your husband, George. So they got divorced, and she was a divorcee, and How she met George, I don't know. But they got married in December of 1914, 2 years after he got divorced. And this is what it says about the divorce was in January of 14. So she's only divorced, you know, 9 months but when he decides to get married. Referring to the decree made in this cause, and it seems to be the decree was granted on faithfulness from her husband. I think he was also George, yeah, which is kind of confusing. George Felix, yeah. And George Thomas O'Donnell doesn't figure in the divorce case at all. And there, another thing saying about him being made bankrupt, the proof that, so you can follow on what happened to him. He didn't, I think he fought in the war for a couple of months, but then got wounded and came back. And he lived until the 1940s. So he went back, and before he went back, he wrote his will, and he left everything that he had, all his possessions, to his wife. So when the mother and father died, then all that was going to go to him would go to the wife. So she had, in 1922, she married a sign man, and I thought that was in there somewhere. But she married in 1922 after he died, then she remarried. So she ended up getting the Newport estate. What was left of it? Most had been sold earlier on to the Land Commission. So this is from now on until we get to the actual day that he gets killed. It just sort of says that you know, they're in and out of the trenches, firing back and forth. Some people get killed. Trenches were very wet. Like, a lot of them would get really bad feet infections from being in the trenches for so long. The king came to visit them in the billets. So there's nothing much happened now. I just put it all up there just to sort of see how routine and boring it seemed to be. It may be that he wasn't as excited about it. You know, that all he could write was in trenches, you know. It probably, if you go out to fight in a war, or if you go out to do anything, and you think it's going to be over in 3 or 4 weeks, and then, you know, here we are almost 6 months later, and nothing happened. So you see, here we are, you know, and he's lost 58 men killed and wounded in the last 48 hours, and he hasn't really said very much about it, you know. Our own dead lying about all over the place, we've buried dozens of them. Okay, they had another visit from Sir Horace Smith Dorgan, thanking him for having saved the situation since they arrived there, having done a great job. Hmm. They move into different, sometimes they have billets which might only be farmer sheds that they took over, and then other times they seem to have huts that they put up and built. But you can see from those pictures of the trenches, and if any of you saw the video to start off with, like, the conditions in them really weren't very good. Quiet day, some shed. Okay. So, June was when he gets killed, so we'll just have a little look at the build-up of what happens in this war. You see, it's three different sets of orders, cancelled in turn. Now, what the reason for this battle that he gets killed in is because the line wasn't straight. There was a sort of a bulge in it, which was called the salient. And they wanted to try and straighten it up, because if they didn't have it straightened up, they could be shooting from three sides at them. Whereas if they were parallel with each other, then they could only be shooting in one direction, and it would make it easier for both of them if the line was straight. Okay, so it was a quiet day, excitement about prospect of leave for officers and men. Very quiet day, but the leave was cancelled. So they decided, you know, that they were going to have when they were going to have the attack, and they sort of had. Once they decided what date they were going to go, they were building up for it, and they were putting out They were putting out all the wires, they were cutting the wires, they were putting artillery in to cut the wire on the Germans' defences so that it would be easier to attack. The night before, four subalterns and an officer were sent out to make a reconnaissance, and the lieutenant was shot by a sniper. All arrangements were made. Final operations orders received about attacking the lines of trenches held by the Germans. The whole brigade was to be employed. The position allotted the 4th Battalion to the right of the line. On our left were the Royal Scots Fusiliers, and on the left of them were the 5th Fusiliers. I'll show you a map in a minute of where we're talking about. The lines of the trenches to be attacked were on the north of the Menin Road, about 250 metres north of the Hoo Chateau. There was a picture of that in the little video at the beginning. Battalion marched out at 4:30 p.m. followed by the Lincolns. We halted for a time and then marched to assembly trenches, which we reached at 11 p.m. Germans kept crossfiring the support trenches. Luckily we stayed. So there, on the 16th, the artillery commenced bombarding and shelling German trenches at 2:50 a.m. and continued with the exception of two short intervals into 4:15 a.m. When our first line jumped off the mark and got through the Germans and into their trench in a marvellous manner, the men were so eager that they went forward a great deal too fast into the second and third German trenches, only to be mown down by our artillery. The artillery, which was behind the lines of the infantry, didn't think that they'd be able to progress so far forward, so they thought they were firing the artillery shells at the German, and the artillery shells were landing on top of their own men because they couldn't do it. They had flags that they put up that the artillery were meant to be able to see, but there was so much dust and debris floating around that the artillery couldn't see the flags. And so a lot of people, just looking at what happened to him, it seems that he was killed by one of his own shells rather than by a German shell. The adjutant was killed with his orderlies and operators by a high offensive shell. The heavy shelling the Germans were subjected to had the most demoralising effect on them. Our men had to spend, he obviously he's not going to write that he was got killed himself, so he was taken over by Lieutenant Peverell, who took over as charge of the regiment. And so he said that Captain O'Donnell was killed with his orderlies by the shell. And their eagerness cost them a number of casualties and stuck out to all his men through the wounded. And they all went to the dressing station to have the wounds. There was a lot of them were killed from their wounds as well as from killing directly. And then quite a lot of them would die from infections that they picked up there. Okay, so if you just look at this map here, this line here is the British on this line here. And then the Germans are in the dark line. This is the bulge here. This is the bulge around the lake. And what they're trying to do is they're trying to drive them back. So there's a straight line between them. So they're not able to snipe here. So O'Donnell was in this part here, the 4th Fusiliers. And what happened was they were meant to go over and to take these ones with the Ys on are German markers for where their positions are. And they were meant to take this one here. But they did so well in getting there that they moved on to about Y-22. And then the artillery would be over here, and they fired shells in there, thinking that they were killing off the Germans that were fighting the Fusiliers, but they actually, the shell landed on themselves. So this is about where he was killed. The 4th Battalion at Bellewaerde is one of the battalions in the 9th Brigade of the 3rd Division. The 4th Battalion Royal Fusiliers were ordered straight in line to be dented by the German possession of Bellewaerde Bay with an attack on the ridge. They were in position east of the Cambridge Road trench at 1:30 a.m. on the 16th of June. The Royal Artillery bombardment was effective in removing the barbed wire and demoralising the Germans, so the capture of the trenches was easier than usual. However, the two supporting companies of the battalion advancing on the west bank of the lake advanced too quickly and became victims of our own artillery fire. Major E. Hutchinson went into the woods to bring the remaining men back to a communication trench, which became subject to enemy counterattacks until they were ordered to retire. Many acts of bravery were performed by men of the battalion throughout the day. Lance Corporal Filter and Sergeant Jones manned machine guns while wounded. Sergeant Smith tended two wounded men under fire. Private Beckett was killed while helping a wounded soldier, and Private McGee continued to deliver messages through shell-swept areas, receiving two wounds. At the end of the day, the ground gained had been lost to the enemy. Out of 22 officers, there were 15 casualties, and out of 820 men, 376 were wounded or killed, victims of gas, shells and bullets. Into the 2nd Lieutenant in the 4th Royal Fusiliers, 23rd of May 1900, promoted Lieutenant 10th of April 1909, and Captain 20th of November 1914. Appointed Adjutant in 15th of January 1913, went to France on the 13th of August and was killed in action at Hooge near Ypres on the 10th of June. Captain O'Donnell was awarded the Military Cross in November and was twice mentioned in Sir John, now Lord French's dispatches. This Brigadier General McMahon, as you can remember, was killed before George O'Donnell, but what he said, he thinks the battalion has done very well out here, and I hope it will continue to do so. George is going strong and is fitter than when he started and can claim a very large share in producing such good results as may have been attained. Colonel Beely Hutchinson wrote to his father and he said, "I cannot tell you what a shock the whole thing has been to me. We were the closest of friends. We slept together, we fed together, we rode together and we fought together, and we never had a row for 7 months. And the only time we've been separated, George goes and gets killed and I get off. It is too sad after all the months he'd been out and the good work he'd done. I myself had a small touch of shell in the head and have come home for a bit, thank God, as I don't think I could have carried on any longer out there without George and the rest. We lost 6 killed and 9 wounded officers, and I had no heart. I was just tired out, and so was George. He went on to the job. His death is a great loss to his country and the regiment. He served so gallantly and so well. There are few of us left who went out of the battalion. George was the only one of the competent officers left after fighting at Newport. I had a great affection and admiration for him. He did work splendidly right through. And then the Brigadier General, Regiment Pinney, he was formerly commanding the Royal Fusiliers. He wrote to his father and he said, "I most distressed you and his mother, George's death. Also the regiment from the army, for he was fulfilling all the promise he showed when he joined. Seeing his name gave me a special shock, for I had just heard of my getting a division and had been talking to staff and hoped to get George appointed to the GSO. So in the old St. Catherine's Church, there was probably quite a lot of you were in, they had concerts and various things, and there was a plaque to George O'Donnell on the war, and it says here, "In fondest memory of George O'Donnell, Frederick Thomas O'Donnell, Captain and Adjutant of the 4th Battalion Royal Fusiliers, Military Cross Monster, twice mentioned in dispatches, killed in action at Hooge near Ypres, 16th of June in his 30th year, only son of Edmund Thomas O'Donnell and Millicent Agnes Thomas O'Donnell, Newport House." So on the 3rd of July they had a memorial service in St. Catherine's Church, and he was conducted by Reverend J.A. Lendrum, who was the rector in Castlebar. The rector in Newport at the time was up with his daughter, who was sick in Dublin. Captain O'Donnell was at the front since the commencement of the war, was twice mentioned in dispatches and was ordered the Military Cross. He was one of the most, this is out of contact there. He was one of the most popular officers in the regiment, brave and fearless, and his death was deeply regretted by his bereaved widow, father and mother. The memorial service was largely attended by friends from Castlebar, Westport, Ballincroy and Newport parish. Here is up here in the Royal Fusiliers. Oh, here he is again. Thomas O'Donnell. In the men engaged in Ypres, it's a big gate, it's like the Arc de Triomphe, and the 70,000 names on of those who were killed in the war before 1916. There's another one about 10 miles away, a place called Tyne Cot, where there's twice as many people, and that's where Lieutenant Stoney is commemorated. There was no bodies found for either of them, so they're just on a whole bunch of names on the thing. This is about the spot where he was killed in here. We went out about 4 or 5 years ago, and there was back and forwards over this area afterwards, and there was big mining explosions afterwards. But that's what it looks like now, and that's still the same car. 07905. And what happened to the mother and father? The father died in 1932, and the mother died the following year in 1933. And that's said, the beloved husband, he was 81 when he died, and so if the son had lived to be that age, he, quite a lot of us would have met him. And this is, it says that the a common attribute with the O'Neills, Earls of Tyrone, and the O'Melaghans, Kings of Meath. The family went to Mayo several centuries ago, set an large estate. Barney was created in 1780, lapsing with the death of the fifth father, Sir George. The deceased, who was the daughter of Captain Richard Alexander O'Donnell, son of Sir Richard, the fourth Baronet, married Miss Edwin Thomas, Barley Hill, Westport, who took her family name, and the only child, Captain George O'Donnell Frederick, was killed in the Great War, leaving a childless widow. The interment took place in the family vault, which is up past Paddock Hill, in the old church of Ireland. Oh yeah, this is where the sign is here. There you can see in marriages in June 1922, violent Thomas O'Donnell, that's what the T stands for, Thomas O'Donnell, and she marries a Syme man, and his name is David A. Syme. Okay, so they married, and I haven't found out too much about him yet. Every night at 8 o'clock, they have, at the men and gate, played the last post to commemorate all the people who were there. And we also, when we were there, we also visited a scene where they have the round tower commemorating all the Irish who were killed in the First World War. So I've just got a few slides here now that would have the inscriptions that were in the scene, and I just played them for you, and you just might sort of think of those people from the parish that died in the First World War.